Hello everyone. Today is the last lecture of this module, and today we are going to discuss about memories. So the first question which we are going to answer in this today's lecture is, if we need to store large amount of data, huge data, then where do we store? Should we store it in flip-flops? So you can see that one flip-flop, should we store it in latches or flip-flop? So one latch is a cross-coupled, can be designed using NAND gates or NOR gates, plus it should have set and reset capabilities, correct? And then flip-flop is an edge-triggered device. So where should we store this data? Flip-flop could be a good option if we also require this data to be accessed synchronously, and data to be stored synchronously, then flip-flop could be a very good choice. However, if we need to store large amount of data or a huge data, then the flip-flop may not be sufficient, because number of flip-flops we would require would be huge. Then one option could be, we can have an array of flip-flops. But let's say the data is even larger. So you have, let's say, 1 megabyte of data. So that means 10^6 bytes. So then array will become so large that the delay of accessing flip-flop would itself be very, very large. So then we would need to have a memory cell structures which could be simple, where the access time to read the data or write the data could be very less. So if the number of bits which we would like to store is huge, and it is actually huge in many cases, you see, when we would like to store you when you would like to store files, when you would like to store songs, movies, the data in terms of number of bits, not only it would reach in megabytes, sometimes it is gigabytes, or sometimes it is even more. So the amount of data which we need to store can become very, very huge, very, very large. So the flip-flop cannot be very efficient structure if we are storing the data for we are storing large amount of data. So wherever we are storing this data, those units can be called memory. Now, if that memory where we are storing the data, it could be flip-flop, it could be made of flip-flop also, it could be made of some other entities. Now, if those memory structures are made up of silicon, any form of silicon, then we call it semiconductor memory, because they are made up of some transistors or combination of transistors or some different type of transistors, may not be conventional ones, then all of them could be categorized as semiconductor memories. There could be other options also, because you see, what we are going to store is 0 and 1, and to store 0 and 1 we just require two states of the matter. So that's why we can use not only semiconductor characteristics like voltage or current, there could be other characteristics of the matter which can be utilized to store the data or store bits 0 and 1s. So magnetic memories are also quite popular. So you take two magnetic, either you say it is magnetic, or you see what is the direction of magnetism. Based on that, you say whether it is 0 or 1. So there we just have to say two properties, whether it is non-magnetized or whether it is magnetized. So you will see, or either you have seen or you will see in other courses, that in magnetic there is a hysteresis loop. So because of that hysteresis loop, so many of the material can be categorized in two of the states. So magnetic properties are used quite popularly to store data. So there we have magnetic tapes or floppy drives, and even the hard disk. Most of us which we use the hard disk which we use HDD hard disk drive, so they are all magnetic in nature. The other properties also people have utilized, like optical properties, whether it is transparent or non-transparent. So our CD drive or DVDs, they are all using this optical property to store 0 and 1. They're all memories. But we are focusing our discussion today on the semiconductor memory. In semiconductor memory, there are further couple of other terms which you will see. One term which you would have popularly seen is RAM, random access memory. What does this RAM means? That means that your memory will have a lot of data. You can consider it like an array of elements. Now, if you can access any of the element at randomly, that means it's a random access memory. In other words, so let's say you have address X, and to access address X, you need not to access address X minus 1 or X plus 1. Then you can call it a random access memory. So that means any of the address can be independently addressed. This random access memory does not say that all the element locations, all the locations will require same amount of time to access, but it just say that any of the addresses can be accessed randomly. Okay. In contrast, there could be sequential access memories. So historically, when people have invented memories or they have started working on memories, so initially there used to be magnetic tapes. So these magnetic tapes are very similar to if you would have seen tape recorder. So there's a brown color tape that used to rotate around. So now, if you want to access anything in between, you have to roll all the tape to that particular point, then only you can access it. So those, when your data is stored on such kind of a sequential device, it would be sequential access memory. It won't be random access memory. You cannot access randomly any particular point. You have to go through a sequence. So today, most of the memories are random access. So either be it a hard disk or be it your storage device or your semiconductor memories. Most of the semiconductor memories, they are anyway random access, but optical drives or hard disk drive, there is still some kind of a sequentiality which we have to maintain. Okay. So another term which is also quite popular is ROM. Read-only memory. So read-only memory is a type of memory where you can only read. So this we have already studied in one of the previous lectures. So there could be various type of read-only memories, which is programmable ROM, electrically programmable ROM, or electrically erasable programmable ROM. So that means if a ROM cannot be written, that will also make it useless. So that's why these ROMs, although mostly they would be used for read purpose, but using some special procedures or using some programming method or maybe some different special equipment, they can still be written. So that's why it's called programmable ROM, so that they can be programmed maybe using a different equipment, but when they are plugged in into device, mostly they would be read, they won't be written. Slowly we are going into an era where these ROMs are also being programmable or being written by these devices, and these devices also become a commodity hardware. So you would have seen that a couple of years back, CD or compact disc or the optical memories used to be only a read-only memory. That's why they used to be called CD-ROM. But then you also get a read-write capability, that you have a CD drive which can write onto these ROMs as well. Okay, so another characteristics of this read-only memory is that when you plug off the power, there is no current, there is no power, then also content would remain onto this. So that's why these read-only memories like CD-ROM or DVD-ROM, they're also used for storage. So for example, if you see your computer, you have one memory which is storage, where all your operating system, all your files are stored. On the other hand, there is something which is read RAM or your DDR RAM. So that RAM will only work when power is there, but otherwise data would be stored onto your storage. So in that way, usually these random access memories, it's again usually, I am using this word usually because most of the time read only memories, RAMs, the way they are designed, they will have no data when power is off. Okay, so that's why there is another special category of RAM which is called non-volatile RAM. Non-volatile RAM, NVRAM, is a RAM which is non-volatile. So that means when power will be plugged off, then also content would remain in that RAM. So it could be randomly accessed, plus it is non-volatile in nature. Okay, so you can also treat NVRAM as a some sort of a read-only memory that you can always read through it. There would be some special procedures that would be employed so that we can write onto it. Okay, so now we would be focusing further our discussion only on the RAM. Now in the RAM, one of the the first question which I would like to ask is that whether your RAM is a combinational design or a sequential design. So let's look at the fundamentals. Combinational design means given an input, your output is going to be same. Here, in case of a RAM or a memory, what is the input? Input may be the address, input would be the data input, and the output would be the data out. Now, in case of a combinational design, given the set of inputs, your output is always same. But here, your output depends on what is stored inside the RAM. So that means it cannot be combinational. Now, is it a sequential design? Yes, it is a sequential because it depends on what you have stored it earlier in previous inputs. So it depends on the previous input. What you have stored in the previous input would determine what would be the output at current address So it's a sequential design, but it is not a synchronous. It may not be synchronous sequential design. It may not have a clock. It may not be synchronized. Output may not be synchronized with clock, or input may not be synchronized with clock. So it may not be synchronous sequential design, but definitely it's a sequential design. The other question, which looks quite obvious, but still I would like to ask, whether it's an analog design or a digital design. Because we are always storing 0 and 1, so it appears that it's a digital design. But when we look at the implementation of most of these RAMs, semiconductor RAMs, then you will see, because we would like to have highest speed, because we would like to have highest performance, so internally they may be designed as analog units. So there may be amplifiers, there may be a continuous signal which is being monitored. So although interfaces are digital, but internal implementation could be analog for these RAMs. So that's why for this course, or for digital design, we consider a cell or one unit where the memory, where the data, one bit of data is being stored. We can abstract it as one unit. Implementation of that unit could be analog or could be digital in nature. Okay, so what is the typical input? As we have discussed, the input would be usually data and address, and there would be additional control inputs where we will say a read, whether we would like to perform a read operation or write operation. The other control input could be chip select, whether we actually want to perform read or write or not. So if chip select is 0, that means we don't want to perform read or write. But if chip select is 1, then based on read and write values, we would either perform read or perform write. Now output would be data. Now when would you see, data is both input as well as output. So when data would be input, when we are doing a write operation, when we are doing a read operation, then data would be the output. So it's a very specific example where data is could be a in output, whether you can write as well as you can read from the same wires. Okay, so these are the two operations which you perform. Either you perform read or you perform a write operations. The other characteristics about the memory is your size. So memory is characterized by your input and output. Additionally, it is characterized by what is the size, how much content it can store. So when we talk about content which it can store, it is typically characterized by how many bytes it can store. So bytes is usually written by a capital B whenever it is written in a short form. And if you are writing bit, then it is written in small b. So you can distinguish if, for example, somebody has written 1k and small b, that means 1 kilobit. But if it is b is capital, then it means that it is 1 kilobyte. Okay, and 1 byte we know has 8 bits. So the typical units for size could be kilobytes, that means 10 is power 10 bytes. And 10 is power 10 is 1024, so we can approximate it to 10 is power 3, so over 1000 bytes. We can also write it as 1KB. Similarly, the other units are 1 megabyte, 10 is power 20 bytes, or 10 is power 6, sorry, 2 is power 20 bytes, or 10 is power 6 bytes. We can also write it as 1MB, capital M and capital B. Further scale could be gigabyte, means 10 is power 9 bytes, terabytes, 10 is power 12 bytes, petabytes, 10 is power 15 bytes, exabytes, 10 is power 18 bytes. So some of these we have to remember. At least when you are buying a computer, then you would have seen kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, as well as 1TB is used quite frequently. But slowly, as we are moving towards cloud data centers, 1 petabytes or 1 exabytes will also become a normal amount of storage that we would require in coming years or coming days. Okay. The other point is also important, that how do we say whether memory addressing, whether it is word addressable or byte addressable, both of these are possibilities. For that, we also have to understand what is word in terms of memory. So word is how many bits are stored in one address or one row. So how many bits can be accessed whenever we are saying you say that data is output, data is input. So how many bits can be accessed when data is out or data is in, that is called word. Now, this word could be, word size could be 4, 8, 16, 64, etc. Now, although word size could be more than a byte, but sometimes memories could be byte addressable. If word size is less than byte, then it is definitely word addressable. But if memory word size is more than a byte, then also you can address it using a byte addressable. Okay, so what does that mean? Let's see with one example. Now, by looking at input and output, this could be a block diagram where you can have a data input, you can have a data output as, and the other inputs are address, read and write. Now, when we are saying data input, we are saying n bits of data can be written and n bit of data could be read out. So that means the word size is n bits. So if address is k, then 2 power k words could be stored in this memory and they can be accessed. So that means we are assuming here it is word addressable. Now, if 2 power k words could be stored and each of the word can have n bits, what is the total size of the memory? 2 power k into n, that many number of bits, and if you divide it by 8, that many number of bytes. Now, in this module, there could be an additional optional input which is chip unable or circuit unable, or you can call it whatever. So, but it's the unable circuit. If this unable is 1, then only it would be performing its functionality. If it is 0, then even data out should be high impedance. There shouldn't be any data out. Okay. So Now let's look at the sizes. So one more thing that here you see that there is no clock. So we are not considering this random access memory as a synchronous sequential design. It's only a sequential design. Okay. The other thing is that because if it is a larger in size, let's say gigabytes or maybe even megabytes, the latency, the access time could be quite larger than the normal clock cycle, the clock cycle of your combinational design. So then it may not be, so when you are saying reading or writing, so you have passed on the address at one clock cycle and maybe it can take 10 to 20 clock cycles to generate the data out. So because further these data out could be generated at variable amount of time. So if it is variable amount of time, then we have to have some sort of a handshake signals which will say that now data out is available, please read it. When it has been read, then only a next address could be given. So this kind of a handshake signals could be given, and if these handshake signals are given, then we can call this particular kind of a memory as asynchronous memory. They're not synchronous, but they are opposite. They're asynchronous. They're always out of sync with our clock. Okay. So now let's talk about sizes. So if you say, let's say n equal to 8 and if k equal to 10, then what would be the size? K equal to 10 means 10 is 2's power 10 words, and n equal to 8 means byte, one word equal to 1 byte. So that means, so if n is equal to 8 and k equal to 10, then the total size is 1 kilobyte. Okay. So let's say n equal to 16 and k equal to 22. If k is equal to 22, total number of words is going to be 2's power 22. That means 4 mega words. And now what is the size of one word? It's equal to 16. So that means 2 bytes. The total size would be 8 megabyte. Now here one point which we can stress upon, that if this memory is not word addressable but byte addressable, then the total number of bits required for the address would be, this k value will become 23, not 22. So that we can address each byte, although data out could be 16. So although still word size is going to be 16, but because if it is byte addressable, then we can address each and individual bytes also. Now let's take one more example. Let's say n equal to 5 and k equal to 12. If k is equal to 12, total number of words are going to be 4096, and 5 bits are there. Now total size would be 4096 into 5 bits, and if I convert into byte, then I have to divide it by 8. So then it comes out to be somewhere around 2560. Okay, so this is how we can calculate the sizes based on what is the address and how many. This is the maximum size, correct? Given an address, this is the maximum size. It could be even sometimes smaller than that. Okay, so this is how we can calculate addresses. Now, how do we implement these random access memories? Random access memories, as we discussed earlier, it could be implemented using flip-flops. But the only issue with the flip-flop is that the number of transistors required, the area required, size is going to be huge. So one flip-flop would have at least 4 AND gates. So because of 4 AND gates, the total amount of circuitry involved, it could range from 8 to 12 transistors. Now because memories are huge, means they are storing huge amount of data, and based on the amount of data, sometimes we have to reduce the cell size. That's why static RAM, SRAM, is a very popular type of RAM implementation. Here it is designed using usually using 6 transistors. So these 6 transistors are implemented like a SR latch, where you have a back-to-back connected your inverters, and then you have set and reset transistors which can help you to set any value or reset any value. Now this SRAM is much faster than flip flop because it doesn't involve any kind of a redundant or unnecessary transistors, and it also requires lesser area than flip flops. So it is lesser costly than flip flops, array of flip flops, but still faster than flip flops. So the only challenge with SRAM is because it requires some sort of analog components, like it requires amplifiers or pre-charged circuitry, which is analog in nature. So that's why when you had to design, it's called custom design. So then you have to, you cannot design it using direct gates. So the process, implementation, fabrication is also different. The other possibility, when your requirement even increases further, then you can design one memory cell using a single transistor. That single transistor work like a capacitor. So if you charge it, it will remain one for a certain amount of time, let's say 1 millisecond or a couple of milliseconds. So you have to recharge it regularly. But the density of this memory is the highest. It would be slower in nature because every time you have to keep on refreshing, keep on recharging. Also, whenever you read any data from this, then again you have to recharge. So because of all those things, DRAM, dynamic RAM, is slower but has the highest density. So also cheaper in price. That's why in our computers, the fastest memory is going to be flip-flop. Slower than that, there would be SRAM, and the memory which is largest in nature, that means your main memory, which is in terms of like 1 gigabyte or 8 GB or 16 GB, that's usually DRAM or dynamic RAM. Okay. As we have seen earlier, so each this memory would have an input, like total memory would have an input of you'll give address, you'll give data input, data output, and then you'll have a read and write, etc. But each memory cell will have only four inputs: data input, data output, select line, and a read write. If select line is one, then that cell would be active, otherwise that cell will not be active. Further, based on this SRAM cell and DRAM cell, we further refine our input output only to two lines. One is select line, that means if select line is 1, then cell would be active, otherwise cell output is going to be high impedance. Another is data line. So this data line could be used for input as well as for the output. Whenever we are using it for data input, then we require some sort of a buffers so that those write would have good amount of charge, good amount of voltage. And whenever we are reading, then we will try to sense what voltage is there in that particular cell. So these data lines work as both input as well as output lines. Now, now let's see that how we would implement that. So this implementation we have already discussed in one of our lecture when we were doing combinational modules. So we implemented our memory as a one dimensional array, and we were using a demultiplexer to read the data, or in other sense we were using decoder and then we were trying to access all the data. Now that single dimensional, one dimensional memory organization could become less effective if the size will grow. So for example, if you would like to implement 1 megabyte of memory, then you would require a decoder which has 20 to 2^20 lines. So this huge complexity could be made simpler by making a two-dimensional memory organization. So in case of two-dimensional memory organization, what we do is we do two things. One, we will divide the address into two parts. One is high part, high end addresses, address bits, and the low end address bits. And then we'll have two different decoders. For example, here what we are taking example is a 1 kilobyte of memory. So in 1 kilobyte of memory, we have divided the addresses into 5 and 5. So these are the lower addresses. These are the higher significant addresses. So these high addresses, when we are we would use decoder here as well as here. So now when we are using decoder here, what you will see, there would be 32 outputs. Here also we'll have 32 outputs. And then each of this dot would actually correspond to a AND gate. So if this is 1 and this is 1, then only select line would be 1 for this particular cell. And if select line is 1, then only that cell would give an output. Otherwise, it would be in high impedance state. So by having this two-dimensional structure, what we are doing is we are reducing the complexity of our decoder. So you see, for example, if I was taking the example of 1 megabyte of memory, so in 1 megabyte there would be 10 to 1024 decoder at one side and 10 to 1024 decoder at the other side, which has much lower complexity than 20 into 10^6 decoder. Okay, so complexity has reduced. The other benefit of this kind of a two-dimensional structure is that your now memory cells are also organized in two-dimensional fashion. Because memory cells are organized in two-dimensional fashion, now they form when we'll physically implement them, they will form a square structure rather than a long structure. So the square structure is also beneficial because now the access time would be equal, more or less equal for all the cells. And also you will see that when you would like to buy a chip, so it more the rectangular in nature, better it would fit onto your final PCB boards. Okay, so here for example, here these are the lower end ones. I can call these as a row decoder. This one I can call as a column decoder. So when a row and column of a particular cell would be 1, when both of them would be 1, for example, X is 1 and Y is also 1, then only that address would be active. So here, that particular address, I can say it is 32 into Y plus X. So because these are the higher end addresses and these are the lower end addresses. So being lower end addresses, they would always correspond to modulo 32 of the address, and this would be whatever is the address divided by 32 would be the A5, A6, A7, A8, A9. Okay, so now this is how two-dimensional memory organizations can be there and which can help us in designing more regular structure as well as lesser cost in terms of area and delay. The other advantage, you can also see that because both of these decoders are working in parallel, so they would be faster. Now the critical part delay is going to be this decoder plus 1 AND gate and then accessing this particular cell. Okay, so this is one way to mitigate the complexity by designing two-dimensional memory organizations or memory structures. The other way to mitigate the complexity is designing it in a hierarchical manner. So when you're saying designing it in a hierarchical manner, then what you do, you can have a two-level decoders. So for example, I can have 4 different memory modules. So all of these four different memory modules can take lower bit of the addresses, and higher bit of the addresses would be taken by decoder. This decoder will say that which particular memory has to be enabled. Now you see, if the address range is from 0 to 1 kilobyte, then the this top 2 bits would be 00. So that means this would be memory 0 would be selected. When the address range is from 1 kilobyte to 2 kilobyte, then the input here is going to be 01. So the first memory 1 module would be selected because this is going to be the output. Similar is the case with the memory 2 and memory 3 module. Now, address, lower bits of the address would be given as an input to all of them. Similarly, data would also be given at all of them. Now, what would happen if this particular memory module is not selected? Because this memory module is not selected, so my data would be in high impedance. So, because this data is high impedance, this is also high impedance, this is also high impedance, and only one of the data is one, so I can simply connect all these wires to give the data. There is no OR gate required, there is no any other circuit which is required. So, this is the fine grain implementation. So, we are not going into further detail of the implementation, which is based on cells or which is based on pre-charge circuitry. If you are interested, I can point you to the links where you can study about those details. Now, with this, mostly we are done with the design or basically organization of memory. Now, let's say we have to model the same memory in a very low code. How do we write? So, we'll write a module memory, and then we'll have these inputs: enable, read, write, address, data input, and data output. And then we have to specify that my input. So basically, enable and read, write are single bit input, because we are going to design 64 word of memory with 4 bits in each word. Okay, so the total number of addresses are 64, so that means 6 bits required. Those 6 bits we can write as 5:0 address, and now each word size is 4 bits, so we can say the data input data in has is a input with 4 bits, 3:0. Now the output is also 4 bit, because my word size is 4 bits, so output is also 3:0. Now we'll talk about this reg definition of data out. Now internally this memory has to be stored in some sort of an array. So this array is going to be 63:0, because there are 64 elements. Each element is of 4 bits. So we are declaring that as a register 3:0. So that means this is the word size and this is the array which we are going to store, where we are going to store our memory. It's a single dimensional array. Now, we can write a behavior code for this very log memory. Now, we can say whenever enable is there, read write is there, data in is there, or address is there, that means any of them will change, then we are going to see what is the, what would be the, there would be change in output. Because it's from the interface, it can be treated like a combinational circuit. Okay, so when any of these inputs will change, my output will change. If enable is there, then only I can check whether read write is there or not. If enable is 1, then only we can check about read write. If read write is 1, so that means we are going to read the data. So where we are reading into data out, and the address, whatever is the given address, that we can take from the from this memory type, and then that can be given as data out. Now, because this data out is written in an always block, so I need to declare this data out as a reg data type. Okay, so if read write is 1, if read write is 0, that means I would like to write which particular thing. I would like to write into this address data in value. So I am saying memory address and then data in, whatever is the in data in, that would be written into this particular address. However, if enable is 0, that means my output has to be in high impedance, so I can specify my output as high impedance if my enable is 0. So this is how we can write very low code for a memory module. And with this, I would finish the lecture, close the lecture, and I can summarize this lecture as 2 takeaway points. One, that these memories, because they are integral part of the digital system, so they are implemented in various ways. Different implementations are there. We generically call them random access memory. Then specific implementation could be SRAM or DRAM, or it could be an array of flip-flops. Now we have seen some of these implementations, and we have also seen some way to because these memories are going to be huge or large, so there could be some, we studied at least two different techniques to mitigate the complexity if the size is large. One is by organizing the memory as a two-dimensional structure, the other is by hierarchically organizing the memory cells. The other thing which we'll see in our coming lectures is that these memories are also integral part of a digital system, because they would be used to store the data, used to store the control, and can be used to store the configurations, and can be stored to store the input. So with this, I would like to close. Thank you very much.